time.
We'll get there. Well, this morning, I want to preach at you for a little bit, if that's okay. These guys upstairs, they're like, "Pastor, what's your title?" I was like, "I don't know. Jesus. I don't know what my title is. I had to, they're making me be creative." And so this morning, I want to talk to you about this. And so I titled it this, Position for Provision and Purpose. Position for provision and purpose. How many need to get positioned for provision and purpose? How many sometimes you just miss the boat? You hear about something too late. And there's other times, I remember this. I remember one time there was a toy store that was going out of business. We were living in Denver, and there was a toy store that was going out of business, and they had everything 50% off. And people were in there, and so my kids were small at the time, so of course we went in and we started looking at stuff, and sometimes, you know, and it was a kind of a high-end toy store. I could tell, I understand why they were going out of business. And, you know, the $50 toy is $25, you know, it's still, yeah, you know, it's a good deal, but it ain't a great deal, right? And so we're kind of strolling through the store, and all of a sudden the manager says, "Hey, can I have your attention, please?" From right now, everything is 90% off. How many know that $50 toy was now $5? Asia got all these collector Barbies. I mean, they were giving us the black trash bags, and we were just dumping stuff. My mom was with us, and I'm like, "Mom, what are you doing?" Because she was just grabbing stuff. I was like, "What are you doing?" She says, "You know, she had a closet full of toys. Every time somebody would invite them to a birthday party or baby shower, she used to go to her closet and she just started, you know." And we were getting batteries, you know, $5 pack of batteries for 50 cents. We just happened to be at the right place at the right time. Has that ever happened to you? Just happened to be at the right place. How many know sometimes it's not just by chance, but it's God ordained? Man, I was lucky. Sometimes, how many know Christians aren't lucky? We're positioned for provision and purpose. Now, some of us have this concept that God's going to give us a pass because we're in a pandemic. Now, we might not say that with our mouth, but we say that with our actions, huh? That God's going to give us a pass because of the pandemic. Well, it's the pandemic. Corona, Omicron, Voltron, Megatron, whatever it is, you know. And we say, but God knows, God knows. How many know that God still saves during a pandemic? How many know that God still heals during a pandemic? That God could, and let me tell you something, this isn't, I want to get this out right of the way. This is not a political message. Don't get this twisted and confused that pastor's coming up here and just, you know, choosing sides or whatever. Let me tell you the side that I'm choosing the side of God. And what I'm seeing is that the church has taken a step back and said, but it's the pandemic, God. Your hands are tied. If God's hands are tied, it's because we tied them. Can God bless through a pandemic? Can God bless you through a recession? He has and he will. How many of y'all died in 2008? Some of you were like, the housing market crashed. Everything went down in the toilet. But guess what? We're still here. And we're still serving God. I want to show you scripture this morning that talks about that. Genesis chapter 26. How many are reading through your Bible? Anybody? Did you just read this last week? How many know this Genesis chapter 26? I'm going to read just some of it because we can get sidetracked with this. Genesis chapter 26, starting with verse 1. And this is what we're going to do. So stick with me. Here we're going to go Genesis 1 through 5, and then we're going to jump to 12, okay? It says, now there was a famine in the land. You get that? There was a what? You know what that is, right? No food. A recession. A pandemic. A depression. They just call it a famine. Now there was a famine in the land besides the previous famine in Abraham's time. And Isaac went to Abimelech, king of the Philistines, in Gerar. The Lord appeared to Isaac and said, do not go down to Egypt. Live in the land where I tell you to live. Stay in this land for a while, and I will be with you and will bless you. For to you and your descendants I will give all these lands and will confirm the oath I swore to your father Abraham. I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and will give them all these lands. And through your offspring, all nations on the earth will be blessed. Because Abraham obeyed me and did everything I required of him, keeping my commands, my decrees, and my instructions. Now we're going to jump to 12, right? It says this. Well, let me tell you this. Then all of a sudden, you know, before we go to 12, all of a sudden, here's this story about Isaac basically doing what Abraham did. You know, he goes into this land, and if you remember this story, his wife is pretty, and he's like, no, that's not my wife, that's my sister. You remember that story? He's like, no, man, that's my sister. Because he didn't want them to kill him and take his wife. And so they found out and they're like, hey, dude, we saw you. And if that's your sister, you got some issues. And so they go to Isaac and they said, hey, come on, what's up? He says, okay, it's not my sister. It's my wife. And you read this and then you keep on going down past 12. And then there's another story about wells. And they would dig a well and then they would get it stolen. They'd dig a well and they get it stolen, right? Dig a well, get it stolen. And there was just all this. And so when you read chapter 26, you see there's a famine in the land. That's my sister. No, that's not my sister. That's my wife. Wells and all this other stuff. And we miss something very important in this chapter. Bible says that there was a famine in the land. What happens in a famine? Nothing grows. Everything's dry. Everything's especially in that time, there's no food. But verse 12 says this: Isaac planted crops in the land, and the same year reaped a hundredfold because the Lord blessed him. We'll stop right. Let's pray. Father God, Lord, I ask that you speak to us this morning. Not my words, but yours. I pray that I decrease, Lord, as you increase. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing and acceptable to your sight. I pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. This is a very powerful scripture. And I believe that this is a scripture for today. And I believe that this is a scripture for us during a pandemic, during a depression, during a time that we just feel like we got to just take a back seat. God, it's a pandemic. Well, we don't have a lot of people. Well, we don't have a lot because it's the pandemic. Well, you know, we used to go out and minister, but the pandemic. Can I be bold this morning? Who do you serve? Now, I'm not saying, you know, that we should. There's other people that are like, oh, you know, you wear a mask. You're succumbing to the spirit of fear. No, that's not what I'm talking about. But I'm saying that there are lost souls out there, and there are people dying out there, and there's people that are hurting right now. And our excuse, but Lord, it's the pandemic. We might have to adjust, but how many know you can still preach Jesus with the mask on? Y'all, come on. God is not, my first point is this: God is not bound by this world. He created this world. He is not bound by it. He is omnipotent, all-powerful. He is omniscient, all-knowing. And he is what's the other one? Omnipresent. Omnicron. He's all-knowing. He is not governed by our rules. If God wants to bless and make you a millionaire in a depression, in a recession, how many know he can? If he wants to bless you with a job during a high unemployment rate, how many know that you know, when you go and say, Lord, I need a job, and God says, but man, you live in California. Have you seen the unemployment rate? I wish I could help you. And we think it's funny, and I know it sounds funny, and I know sometimes I'm a comedian, but let me tell you something like this. We might not say that, and we might not, but sometimes we don't even come to God with these problems because it's like, but God, I would come, but it's a recession. But do you know who's in office? Sometimes we make an excuse for not walking and stepping into our blessing, and we don't plant seed. Isaac, God told him, this is your home. Make it your home, plant crops. Nothing in here does it say that Isaac was like, but these are foreign people. I don't like them. They don't like me. And by the way, you ever hear of a famine God? They keep stealing my water. They must have been from L.A. So you got that. But God is not bound by this world. God is not bound by our rules and regulations. God didn't take a back seat and say, oh, do you know who your governor is? Do you know who's in office? Do you know who your senators are? Do you know who the president is? Do you know who all these people are? I can't bless you. Time and time again, you start reading your word and you see who was in office during these times that God did something mighty and miraculous. They were godless people. And God took care of them. And God continued to bless his people when they were faithful, when they followed his decrees, when they followed his word. It didn't matter who was in office. And I know this sounds very political, but I want us to get beyond the political and get to what God wants to do in our lives. Because when God says plant crops, what should we do? When God says plant the seed, you got to plant the seed. I know it's difficult. Believe me, I know. And I would like to stand behind this pulpit and say, oh, you know, when I listen to God, I do everything he says. I would like to tell you that. Man, there's some times it just doesn't make sense. And because we have an unseen God and we focus and we see the famine before us, we see the destruction, we see the sin, we see all this stuff before us. And it just doesn't add up here. But God is not bound by this world. It's hard for most of us to imagine going through a famine. But not so much. Do you remember just a few months ago what we were doing for toilet paper? What we were doing to just, and even to this day, I think my wife posted something on Facebook about, you know, Valentine's Day candy. They found Valentine's Day candy, but they can't keep the other stuff stocked. There was a famine. Isaac was trying to save his family from the reality of this terrible famine. And God tells him he's going to bless him in the midst of all of it. That doesn't make sense. Isaac would have known firsthand of God's ability to provide after his experience on the altar. There are some times, let me tell you something. You know why I have faith in God? Because he's done it before. Amen. And that's sometimes that's all I have. And that's all I can hold on to. Lord, you've done it before. Please do it again. I know you can do it again. Sometimes we go through the famines, the spiritual famines. Come on, somebody. Sometimes we go through a spiritual famine in our life, a physical famine. in our health. Sometimes we go through that and we say, why? Why do I have to go through this? Lord, I've preached your word. Lord, I've studied your word. I've been faithful. And yet, this? Really? And then all of a sudden somebody comes in and says, man, I've been going through this. And you resonate with them because you know that hurt. You know that abandonment. You know that pain. Listen, I've been in your famine. I've been in your famine. And let me tell you something. Let me tell you what God did for me. He got me out of this famine. When I rose up and I planted seed, it was hard not to lick my wounds. It was hard not to succumb to the rest of the world, to everything around me. But I stood up and I followed what God told me to do, and I planted seed. And look at where I'm at now. And if God can do it for me, he's not a respecter of man. If he did it for me, he will do it for you. God is not bound by this world. What does that mean? That means that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And so if he is the God of miracles back in the Old Testament, then he is the God of miracles today. And he will be the God of miracles tomorrow. Regardless of famine, regardless of recession, regardless of your situation, regardless of a pandemic, God is the God of miracles. My second point is this: God calls for obedience. God calls for obedience. In a time that would have been extremely difficult, God asks Isaac to do something that defies logic. Sometimes it just doesn't make sense. I want to tell you a story about, you're going to get to know us. And you may look at me and you're like, man, that dude's cool. Good looking. Drives a fancy truck. Let me tell you something. Before the truck, I was rolling in a Chrysler 300. Chrysler Trehundo, black, tinted windows, rolling, beat sound system. I don't know what that has to do with anything. But God has blessed us, and God continues to bless us. And don't let any of this fool you. It's all by the grace of God. And when we first got married, a couple of weeks before our wedding, my wife loses her job. And we were kids. We didn't think we were kids, but we were kids. She was 20. I was 23. About to turn 24, right? Yeah. And she was fresh out of high school. I was fresh out of Fresno State. Came back to Colorado. People were, if you don't know, I actually lived in the Central Valley for a while, in Central Valley for about 3 years. I mean, 5 years. And my friends would say, why are you going back to Colorado? I said, because all the women here are too liberal. I'm going to go back to Colorado and get me a Mexican woman that's going to make me tortillas. With your laughter, Pretty sure you know that that didn't happen. But we, not a lot of people were for our marriage. People saw me as this church boy. They didn't even know my wife. My wife had been going to that church for well over 6 months before I even got there. And they didn't even recognize her until I started dating her. She even accepted Christ in that church, and people didn't even know it. There wasn't a lot of people that were happy about our marriage. My parents weren't, were going through a hard time. They couldn't help us. Her mom was a single mom. She couldn't help us. So we did what we could. It was up to us, and we paid for our wedding. And then all of a sudden, she loses her job 2 weeks before. And we go through the wedding. We end up paying for everything. Had to cut some corners. In fact, we weren't going to feed anybody. We were going to give them cake. That's all we had. That's all we could afford. It's like, you guys come to our wedding, but we got cake. And at the last minute, my uncle and aunt came from Las Cruces, New Mexico. And they found out that, what? Mexican wedding? No food? Like, we can't do this. And so they said, you know, mijo, we're going to, our present to you is we'll take care of the food. And so they did. They made this great Mexican meal. And I appreciate them for that. God provide. God provided. And we were so young. We didn't have a honeymoon. But they said, you know, you guys just need to get away for a couple of days. And so we hopped in the car and we started driving, and we were in Denver. We ended up in Santa Fe. And we spent a couple of days there. There's some really cool, funny stories there, but I got to save something for something else. But we come back and we go to church. And that Sunday, the pastor preaches this message about source and resource. Source and resource. How God is your source and he provides the resources. Let me tell you something. Your job is not your source. If he wants to use Apple or IBM or McDonald's or Kohl's or whatever, that's just a resource. God is your source. If he wants to use the government, if he wants to use your parents, if he wants to use your kids, whatever the case may be, God is your source, and he will provide the resources. And that message has stuck with me ever since that day, 26, 27 years ago. And to drive the point home, instead of getting the offering bags or the offering plates, they picked up an offering, and the ushers came in with a wheelbarrow. Hey, You want to have big faith, you got to have, you know what I'm saying? And they gave us little bags. I don't know why. And I was touched and I said, Lord, I'm going to trust in you and I'm going to be obedient. God calls for obedience. And I said, and I think I had $2 in my wallet. That's all I had. Nothing in the bank. I had $2. And my wife to this day is a change freak. Anybody like that? You just change. And so in her purse, I mean, don't even try picking up that thing. That thing's that. Yeah. You know, we got a change shortage. But she had change and she got a temp job. She was going to start a temp job that week. And I told her, one of my first duties as the priest of the home, you understand what I'm talking about? I said, give me everything you got. And she's like, this is bus fare. I said, I'll wake up early and I'll drop you off. We'll make it work. But God calls for obedience right now. Amen. It wasn't a lot, guys. Maybe $5. But it wasn't the amount. It was saying, Lord, that's all we have. That's all I got. And I heard the Lord saying, that's all I want. I just want your obedience. It's not the amount. I just want your obedience. And we dumped all that money in there, change and all. Not knowing. And I tossed it. Such a crybaby. I tossed it in that wheelbarrow. And it didn't. Do anything for the church, but how many know it did something for me? I want to tell you this real quickly. Anna was fresh out of high school, and I'll let her tell you her story. But she was fresh out of high school. She actually didn't even graduate from regular high school; it was opportunity high school. Okay. But fresh out of high school, didn't even know how to type, okay? But some lady died, had a heart attack at the job, older lady, at a investment firm. And they hired Anna, and they said, just answer the phones. Take messages, answer the phones, that's all your job is. Until we can hire, you know, we got to go to this lady's funeral. And then we got to hire somebody. And so Anna goes to this job in an investment firm. And she starts just answering phones. And as they're interviewing people, they do the funeral thing, they're interviewing people. All this time, they're like, well, you know, since you're here, let me teach you how to do this. Well, let me teach you how to do this. Well, let me teach you how to do this. And it got to the point that the hiring manager found favor with Anna. How many know when you have find favor with God, you find favor with man? And the hiring manager went to, it was a big, I don't know if you remember Norwest. Norwest was a big company back then. But the hiring manager went to the HR director and said, I don't like any of these people. I want to hire Anna. Says, Anna doesn't qualify for this job. You have to have a degree. You have to have this and you have to have that. She doesn't know any of this stuff. She says, that's all right. I'll teach her. And the HR director was like, I don't suggest. It's not my recommendation that you do this. Hire this 20-year-old kid that doesn't know anything, coming off the streets, coming off, you know, an opportunity school. And the hiring manager said, I don't care. Thank you for your advice, but get the paperwork started because we're hiring Anna. I believe because we were obedient that Sunday morning and we said, Lord, I don't know. I don't know how. I don't have an answer. I'm in a famine in my life right now, in my finances, in my world. I'm just going to be obedient. That God blessed her and God blessed us. To this day, you as a church are receiving blessings as she steps into this administrative position in this church that she learned way back 20-some years ago when God, isn't that awesome? It's all of obedience. God calls for obedience, and that's what I want you. Isaac was obedient, and this is what we need to do. We have to be obedient during the time of famine, during the time of a pandemic, during the time of a depression, during the time of a recession. Whatever is going on in your life, be obedient. Not to your circumstances, but to His word. I think that's for somebody today. My last point, I'm sorry about this, guys. I'm not. I ain't gonna lie to you. Will you just give me like 2 more minutes? Anybody? Somebody give me 2 minutes? Who'll give me 2 minutes? 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. All right, now I'm comfortable. My last point. Every time I say that, I remember, I think I told you that, but what does it mean when a pastor says, in conclusion, absolutely nothing? But my last point is this: God's people can flourish in times of famine. Some of you are waiting. Some of you have been on the shelf. Some of you are waiting for everything to go back to normal. And then can I tell you something? That's what the enemy wants. He wants the church to step back. He wants God's people to step back, to be dormant. But if there is a time that the church needs to rise up and start planting crop and start planting seed and start harvesting, it's today. It's right now. Regardless of the pandemic, regardless of your financial situation, regardless of the church's financial situation, regardless of, but we just got a new pastor and he's weird, man. Regardless of all that, regardless of who your pastor is, how many know that doesn't work in heaven? Well, man, did you see the pastor I had, God? What have you done? I got to stand for my own stuff. And let me tell you something I can't say, but God, I had to pastor during a pandemic. But God, you know those people in Patterson. Come on, give me a pass. I'm just kidding. God's people can flourish in time of famine. You know why? Because we're not subject to a famine. We are not of this world. We may live in this world, but we are not of this world. And you need to remember that. You need to remember where your citizenship lies. You know why we can come together? Because we know where our citizenship lies. It doesn't lie in the skin color. It doesn't lie in our heritage. And let me tell you something, I'm proud of my heritage. But I know where my salvation comes, and my salvation doesn't come from Cesar Chavez. Let's be serious about that. My salvation comes from Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. And I am not of this world. I'm a citizen of the Most High God. And you can be proud of who you are, and we celebrate our differences, and we celebrate our cultures, and that is awesome. And I'm not saying to downplay it, we celebrate it. Be who you are, because that's how God made you. I was in the land of rednecks, and I thank God for rednecks, man. Let me tell you something. If it wasn't for rednecks, our church would be in some major problems. Like, our air conditioner doesn't work. What's going on? Pastor, don't worry about it. I got this. Thank you, Jesus. God's people can flourish. Rise above this famine. Rise above your situation. Rise above everything that's going on in your life. With the pandemic, with the recession, with your family, with your financial situation, with your family situation. You are a child of the Most High God, and God is telling you, it's time to plant crops now. It's time to plant crops now in the city of Patterson. It's time to plant crops now in your home. Even though your home may be in disarray, it's time to plant crops now in your marriage. Even though, you know, it's time to plant crops in your children. It's time to plant crops with your grandchildren, with your neighbors, in your ministry. This is proof. This scripture is proof that God is not subject to a famine. He is not subject to sickness. He is not subject to disease. He is not subject to a recession. He is not subject to a pandemic. He's not subject to any of this. That the word of God will be preached, and he will still move in the hearts of his people. And I want to tell you something today, and this is why I want to preach this message on the forefront. God's about to do something great in this place. And it's not going to be after the pandemic. It's going to be now. We just got to be obedient. Let's end with a couple of scriptures. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 7 through 10. But we have this treasure in jars of clay. How many know this scripture? To show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. Doesn't that just relieve you? It's not up to you. It's not up to me either. We are hard pressed on every side. How many can say amen to that? Amen. We are hard pressed on every side, but not crushed. Perplexed. Ooh. Some of us got to look up perplexed, but once you see the definition, you're like, I'm perplexed. But not in despair. Persecuted. not abandon. He will never leave you, and he will never forsake you. Struck down, but not destroyed. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. Somebody needs to highlight that in their Bible. Next scripture. Psalm 62, 5 through 8. Oh, rest. Some of you need rest. Some of you have been sleeping, but you haven't had rest. And I pray that God give you rest. But find rest, oh my soul, in God alone. My hope comes from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken. My salvation and my honor depends on the church. On the church people. My salvation and my honor depends on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge. Trust in him at all times. Oh, people, pour out your hearts to him, for God is our refuge. Selah. I know some of you need those scriptures. I want to pray for you real quickly. Oh, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Lord God, I just come before you and I thank you for this time. I thank you for your words. I pray that we would come and we will be obedient to your word. Lord, you've never, ever left me. You've never forsaken me. You have never been late. And you're never early. Sometimes I want you early. But you're an on-time God. Help me to be obedient. Help me to look beyond the famine. Help me to look beyond the pandemic. Help me to look beyond the sickness. Help me to look beyond the sin. Help me to look beyond all these things that are just weighing so heavy on my heart. Help me to look beyond this and see what you have in store for me. That I can be obedient to your word. And if you tell me to plant crop, Father God, I'll plant crops. Even though it doesn't make sense to me, even though it defies logic, even though people may think I'm crazy, but God, I want to be faithful to you and I want to be obedient. Help us, God. Help us. Lord, and I just pray for your people. I know some of them, I'm not ignorant to the fact that there's some people that are hurting right now. There's some people that haven't had rest. There's some people that are, they're living in a famine. And whether it be physical, financial, spiritual, emotional, whatever the case may be, they're in the midst of a famine right now. And all they can see is desolate, destitute, nothing growing, always lacking. But I believe that you're telling them, it's time to plant crop. It's time to get up and start to work. I promised you. That I would bless you. And I'm not going back on my word. I'm going to bless you and I'm going to bless your people. I'm going to bless your family. But I need you to get up and I need you to plant some seed. I need you to be obedient. I know there's a famine in your heart. I know there's a famine in your life. I know there's a famine in your marriage. I know there's a famine in your family. I know there's a pandemic. I know that there's sickness. I know that these situations aren't perfect. But you got to trust me. Thank you, Lord. Pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Church, why don't you stand? Let's pray to be dismissed.